in his future endeavors. Vice Chancellor Insira Mottua. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir.
To address the gathering, now let us have the honor of inviting the President of Electrical Engineering Society, Dr. Lindula Vidyanagama Arachchi.
Honorable Deputy Minister of Power and Renewable Energy, Member of Parliament, Mr. Ajit P. Pereira, Professor Nalin Vikramarachchi, Head Department of Electrical Engineering, distinguished panel members, respected invitees, my dear colleagues, students, ladies and gentlemen. It is a great pleasure to have you all at the annual flagship event of Electrical Engineering Society, ESOC of University of Moratuwa. As a member of the ESOC batch who initiated the panel discussion in 2001, it is an honor to continue the legacy as the president of ESOC in 2016 with a big step forward, organizing it as a roundtable conference. ESOC has a clear lead in uniting electrical engineering students, academic staff members of the university, and past electrical engineering graduates of university as one family. The society aims to provide opportunities for the undergraduates to develop individually by building their leadership skills, organizing skills, teamwork, and communication skills. The annual panel discussion has always been the platform to brainstorm on issues and future directions of the local power sector. With the paradigm shift to roundtable conference, the theme for 2016 is Energy, Facts and Myths, which is timely and relevant topic when the present context of the Sri Lankan power sector is considered. As the president, I am very happy to say it was a very busy year for ESOC. Please let me summarize the other activities we organized this year. ESOC organized the very first international conference, 2016 Electrical Engineering Conference, ECON, with a great success. We were able to gather researchers and speakers from around the world, creating a wide network for the university as a whole. Having a strong team, ESOC was able to expand its arm even further, touching the aesthetic skills of engineering undergraduates and strengthening the ESOC family bond. It is with immense pleasure I say that ESOC organized a musical event, 2016 ESOC Satsara Dahana, for the very first time and initiated the 2016 ESOC family get-together, bringing high success and pleasure for the students and the staff. We Are With You, the special charity program organized annually by the ESOC for the students of the Deaf and Blind School Ratmalana, was also continued, achieving a high success. I am most honored to be part of a society that has a proud history and delighted by its achievements. I hope that this year roundtable conference will mark another success for ESOC and provide better directions to clear the misconceptions related to the electricity generation sector and brainstorm giving facts on achieving better energy security for the country. Thank you very much, and please enjoy the evening. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Now we take this opportunity to gratefully acknowledge and thank our silver sponsor, ACL Cables, and also our bronze partners, AW Engineering and United Tractors and Equipment, without whom this would not have been a successful event. Now we are ready to move on to the most significant segment of the event, and that being the discussion, the roundtable discussion of this conference. For that, we cordially invite the following dignitaries to assume their seats at the head table.
Dr. Narendra De Silva, Head of Engineering at Lanka Electricity Company, Private Limited.
Dr. Priyanta Vijayathunga, Principal Energy Specialist at Asian Development Bank.
Dr. Thilak Siyambalapitiya, Managing Director at Resource Management Associates Private Limited.
Dr. Mahesh Javira, Senior Lecturer, Department of Civil Engineering, University of Moratuwa.
Engineer Buddhika Samarasekara, Chief Engineer, General Planning Unit, Transmission and Generation Planning Branch, Ceylon Electricity Board.
Professor Preena Das, Associate Professor, Department of Electrical Engineering, University of Moratuwa.
Dr. Tusita Sugathapala, Senior Lecturer, Department of Mechanical Engineering, University of Moratuwa.
Engineer Damita Kumarasinghe, Director General of Public Utilities Commission of Sri Lanka. Now it is with pleasure we hand over the control to the moderator of the roundtable conference, Dr. Narendra De Silva. Dear sir, over to you.
Thank you very much. While I warmly welcome the panelists to the forum, I would rather say the Honorable Deputy Minister has quite well moderated the event. So let me opt to call myself rather than the moderator, the facilitator. So having said that, let me to set up the premise of this roundtable discussion, where we'll be posing questions in the first round with 5 minutes timing, and we'll go for another round of questions for another 5 minutes. Having these two rounds in place, I suggest to have a cross questioning among the panelists, and then to go open the forum for the audience to pose questions. Further, I would like to set up the premise, and I would like to bring out 2 points. The first thing I think is that, being our topic about facts and myths, I like to say that there's another element that we need to keep in mind, which is called policy. So policy, of course, is always dependent on facts, but what happens is there is another level where the policy is being formulated. At that level, there may be certain facts which are being aggregated into the policy, but when it comes to the decision-making level, always there may be policy also within the forum. So having brought in the policy context into the picture, let me say there is another important thing. There are two philosophical faculties. One philosophical faculty says that policy should not be questioned. If everybody is going to question policy, then there won't be any policy. So if there's a zebra crossing, don't question the zebra crossing, but cross it. Otherwise, there will be a lawless society. There's another group of philosophers who are the naturalists, say that no, if the policy is not based on facts, then question the policy. So I think if you go into a very philosophical background, today the discussion would place in somewhere there, whether we are naturalists or positivists. Having said that, let me open the forum for questions. My first question goes to Professor Priyanta Vijayathunga. Professor, now we know that the world context is largely changing, and at the moment we are going through a paradigm transformation of the world policy regarding funding as well as environment. How does that affect to a developing country like Sri Lanka, and what sort of policy context that we should adopt given this paradigm change?
Yeah, thank you very much, Narendra. First of all, let me thank all the organizers for getting me down here. It would be it's quite nice to be here after so many years in ASOC panel discussion. To start off with, actually, frankly, there is no real paradigm shift as such. Eventually, the energy sector policies will have to be based on the what we call energy trilemma, that is energy security, affordability and energy access, and sustainability. Those are the three areas which you need to look at when you form energy policy. As you can very well see, they are sometimes in conflict with each other. Affordability may not go very well along with sustainability sometimes, and also sustainability may not go along with the energy access and energy security. So so these are the three basic principles on which any energy policy should be developed. And within that, of course, you have sub areas where you focus on. And in that, of course, you know, based on this, you have all these countries have international commitments. One good example is the commitments Sri Lanka has made in COP21, recently concluded Paris Agreement, and I presume they are now nationally determined contributions. Within that, you have to confine your energy policies within that. And also, when it comes to financing, you may have all these policies, but eventually the generation or transmission or distribution plans, if they cannot be financed with the kind of policies you have within the country, then the whole purpose of a policy is lost. So that's something which is quite critical. So within that, you know, you have many other things which comes in when it comes to policies. So the basic principle is that it should be based on sustainability, access and affordability, and energy security. I'll stop at that and wait for the questions later on.
Okay. Thank you very much, Professor Priyanta Vijayathunga. Now, once in the premise is set with reference to security, affordability, and sustainability, let me ask from Dr. Tilak Seblapidya regarding the energy generation planning. Generation planning, in its absolute terms, as well as how it occurs in Sri Lanka. Can you comment?
Thank you very much, and many thanks to the Electrical Engineering Society, and also very specially to the Deputy Minister who actually set the tone and the background to most of the discussions that will happen here. And without any reservation, I can say that the sector has got its first Deputy Minister who cares to spend several hours with us in discussing and perhaps sometimes debating very relevant issues. So having said that, what generation planning should be, and your question is, are we doing it in the right way? How do other people do it? Now, you heard from the Deputy Minister himself, that Sri Lanka, or rather perhaps power generation, is the only infrastructure element for which there is a 20-year plan. So I continue to believe that that's a good thing, because we know in which direction the generation function of the country is moving and what should be the specific investments that have to be done and the accompanying and additional infrastructure investments such as transmission and distribution. How do other countries do it? India does it in a very different way. I would say in a rather simplistic way. But we should not forget the perception of energy security and reliability in India is very different to what we perceive as a secure energy supply. For example, India has a free market for electricity, and the price of electricity is determined once every half an hour. And certain distribution utilities will tell their control center, if the price increases above 10 rupees a kilowatt hour, you just cut off. You just cut our supply off. So there could be situations where capacity is available, but because the price is not affordable, there is load shedding. So they do it, they do the short-term planning as well as the long-term planning in a very different way. But there are countries, many countries like in Sri Lanka, for example, Thailand, the Philippines, the Pakistan, to a certain extent Bangladesh, who do planning in the same way. relatively clear set of policies and least cost principles subject to certain constraints, and then going through a series of scenario evaluations, and finally making a plan which in certain countries is put out for public comments, and for the last few years we also have been putting it out for public comments and then finalizing it and going ahead with the implementation. So in my view, given the practice of planning elsewhere in the world, we are not far out. Our problem in general has been the inability to implement the plan with one focus. With one focus, because if we, even if, you know, as we know, there are conventional options, there are new options, there are renewable options, there are hydro options. So whatever we plan, once we agree on a plan, we need to go ahead with the plan. And why do we make 20-year plans for generation and not 5 years? That is because it takes actually, honestly, at least 15 years to build a large power plant or to develop a large renewable energy resource. I'm not only talking about nuclear, coal or gas, which takes definitely physically fairly long time on the ground. Even for a good renewable energy development project, which may be distributed all over the country, it takes a long time. Whereas to build a diesel power plant, actually you can buy it in 5 days and have power, right? So to have the correct mix, you need time for projects to mature and build. So that's why this long time duration. So in summary, I will speak more in the next round. In fact, I like one of the respondents to the interviewer over here. When the interviewer asked, do you know that there is a decision to go for gas? One of the respondents said, I do not know. So, but many people would say, yes, I know, and that's good, because we have not given them the information about the fourth dimension, that is the cost and the price. Later on, perhaps I can elaborate. Sri Lanka's electricity price is just above the water. It's not the most expensive in the world. Our household customers using electricity more than 180 kilowatt hours until 2 years ago were the people who were paying the highest price of electricity on this earth. But we have now come down from that level of graduation. Now South Korea charges the highest price in the world for top block household customers. We are just below South Korea. So, but then I'm not too worried about household customers. I'm more concerned about the commercial and industrial customers. Any impact on incorrect planning, inability to implement the plan, that will have on commerce and industry. Because we are right there, there is really no further room to increase. Our investors have already gone to other countries, including countries who are and who have been operating in Sri Lanka. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Dilaksimla Pitiya. Now, having the international policy in place and the generation planning context in place, I think we'll go to Dr. Mahesh Jayadeera. In asking this broadly question, topic of environment, how the environmental cost been included in generation, and in that context, how does this coal and LNG scenario been placed?
Yeah, I was in fact entrusted with the most difficult task of saying people whether this environmental pollution takes place because of the coal or not. I would like to, you know, take the case study in Nolachodi. That is what we have. And I was fortunate enough to look into the data collected by the Rakhmujia engineers. I mean, thanks to them, they have collected many data on the environmental factors and also the. So all what I'm going to say are based on the data that have been collected. So therefore, I'm not going to, you know, present you any image or maybe any, I would say, a school of thought proposed by so-called the environmentalist. Though I'm an environmentalist, I believe facts and figures. When it comes to the coal power, everybody knows that the air pollution is inevitable. So therefore we have been concentrating on three air pollutants, NOx, SOx and particulate, which is abbreviated as PM. And then we have, when you look at the emission standards that have been proposed, particularly in our region, ours is one of the most stringent. If you put it into the figures, Sri Lankan proposed standard would be for NOx 300 milligram per megajoules, SOx 520, particulate 4, which are very, very stringent. Whereas when you look at the other countries, they are not as stringent as ours. We have been right at the moment maintaining most of these. I will give you the figures later. But when it comes to carbon dioxide emissions, we don't have a standard as such. If you look at the, in nutshell, the carbon dioxide emission from the fossil fuel in Sri Lanka, the record says the per capita emission would be 0.78 tons. Per capita says that per person. The same in India, 1.58 as opposed to 0.78 in Sri Lanka. China has gone many times, that is 6.08 compared to ours, 0.78. Then one can argue, why we are Buddha? Whereas all the other people are emitting carbon dioxide. Whereas all the environmentalists, the public, pressurizes us to control. The issue here is the location in which the plant is going to matter a lot. We being the island, the issue here is when you emit the carbon dioxide, there will be an issue where the carbon dioxide can be, particularly since we are in the island, it can stay within Sri Lanka itself because of our meteorological conditions. Unfortunately, up to now, we have not tried this with what you call the regional modeling. Unless you have a regional model, you are not in a position to model it. If you go to EIA, even EIA, we have not done this. We have done the simple stochastic modeling where we have not looked into the regional importance, how the regional meteorological condition affect. So therefore, it's impossible for me to say that whatever the emission in terms of carbon dioxide affect us or not, I'm not in a position to answer. Supposing if it affects us, what we need to do is, in the world, the new technology is being now proposed, which is still at the pilot stage, which is called the carbon capture and storage technology, where what you do is you do the adsorption to, you know, capture the carbon in the form of, you know, carbon particles, and then you go and bury them so that the sequestration takes place. That is, over a longer period of time, carbon will be released to the environment. So therefore, you are safe. It won't go straight away to the environment, because you know that the carbon dioxide is a greenhouse gas, so that affects us a lot. But unfortunately, the impact of the carbon dioxide emission by Lakvijaya is not still known. So therefore, what is important is, if somebody is worried, we should be able to, you know, ask like Priyanta from the ADB to help us, give us the regional model, so that we can run the model and then show whether it is going to have an impact or not. Still, we have not done. So therefore, I'm very sorry to say that there is no answer for this. Definite answer I can't give you. But when you look at the NOx and the SOx particulate, yes, of course, coal power plants will definitely bring in most of these air pollutants into the atmosphere, stratosphere. And if you look at the, basically the coal, and with 0.6% sulfur content, which I believe we have, because the EIA, one of the conditions says that it has to be less than 1%. So therefore, with 0.6% sulfur content, usually coal steam technology will bring in 40 milligram per megajoules of PM, whereas combined cycle natural gas gives rise to zero. You compare with 40 to zero, I'll come to that later. And the carbon dioxide is 94.6, which we are not going to reduce at all because we don't have any mechanism in Lakwijaya to control carbon dioxide emissions, so that same goes out. And SO2, the value would be 0.455, the permissible is 0.52, but we have been maintaining 0.056 because we have the control mechanism. Whereas the NOx, the coal streams gives rise to 0.3, the permissible level is also 0.3, but we have been maintaining 0.26. But all these values I have looked into, it's fairly good, thanks to the Lakwijaya engineers, that they have been maintaining. But there are certain occasions where you have found certain exceedance. But when you look into the exceedance, we found that there are some, you know, the technology failures. If you just go and see the other countries, same thing must have had. You say, I have seen in Thailand, I have seen in China, I have seen in the, also in Korea, that the same conditions prevail. Because it is inevitable that you can say, at any time, the failures can occur. When the failure occurs, definitely the values are going to be on the rise. But the our job is to make sure that you put them into the corrections as quickly as possible. So I believe that the Lakwijaya people have done it, but I have not found very many exceedances there when you look at from 2012 to 2015. And still we have one small issue where I have no answer when it comes to mercury. And even the CV and the PUCSL report says that the Norochole emits between 2012 to 2015 1,232 kilograms of mercury. 1,232 kilograms of mercury. But this is not to alarm you. Remember, when the mercury goes off in the form of vapor, it is sometimes very difficult to even measure because you are talking of, in fact, micro levels. We are not equipped enough to capture these micro level mercury, but when you just take the entire load that has gone for a, let's say for a year, it is in fact fairly high. But what is this important here is if you look at the amount of mercury in CFL bulb, it's going to be 4 milligrams per one bulb. 4 milligrams. But this 4 milligrams comes out if it is broken. So therefore, HG mercury from the coal power plant is 117,000 milligrams per 1 megawatt hour. That is the nominal amount that has been emitting from the coal power plant. Meaning, if you just take the equivalence, 308 million bulbs need to be broken. 308 million bulbs need to be broken, which is very, very, you know, impossible. So therefore, we believe that the mercury, if it is present, are mainly because of the fact that the coal power plants, you know, emit mercury in the form of mercury vapors. If you look at the Sri Lankan soil, we have done for the World Bank in 1999, the worst place is Port of Colombo. Port of Colombo in 1999, the mercury level was less than 1 milligram per kilogram in soil. That is the worst place in 1999. In 2015, we did the same studies, similar studies for, again for the World Bank. Then we found in Colombo and the south, and the suburbs, the values have gone more than 3.5 milligrams per kilogram, which is alarming. Question is, we don't know how we got this much of mercury in our soil, particularly in Colombo. It may be from cosmetics, deep cosmetics. It may be from, as we mentioned, the CFL bulbs, or the other source would be coal power plant. So therefore, this question is before us, but the answer we don't know. And I got the opportunity of going through the entire data set collected by Virtually people, and these are the issues which are envisaged for which I have no answers. Mercury emission, yes, it is high, but it has not been captured. We don't know the real situation, so therefore we need to go for a bit of a higher technology to capture them, to understand whether it is true or not. And also we found that the continuous monitoring has been in place, but unfortunately nobody is accountable. When you collect the data, nobody knows what to do, even though environmental authorities are there. It is just a collection of data. Can we be able to study on this and see what is going to happen in future? That particular part is not going to happen. And then, when you look at the seawater FGD, which is in place now, that has been working perfectly, but my question is, sometimes it may not be 99% removal, though it has been said that it is going to reduce 99%, it is not sometimes. Sometimes it works. And also we have a big issue of the disposal of water mesh. Now recent past it has come even to the fire. And when you go there, it has been a real catastrophe where you can see the airborne dust has now strewn in many places, so that the people have had lots of issues. We need to come up with a policy decision. Government needs to mediate to find the location where we can be able to dump this ash, because that's a national level problem. And also the stack emission. Though we see that the stack is 50 meter high, it doesn't, you know, bring anything. It has been bringing soot particles over there. So therefore, we need to look into that as well. Last thing, carbon dioxide and water vapor in the air is abundant. But this will definitely lead to acidification and desertification. But we don't have, as I mentioned earlier, models to study. How important this is, we don't know. Everybody is talking, saying, yes, this will lead to acidification, but that's not what is required for us. We being engineers, scientists, we need to find out the degree to which it happens. So therefore, those are the open-ended questions that I have had. Thank you. Sorry for taking more time.
Thank you very much, Dr. Jayaveera. Though that red light ran half the way, I never wanted to disturb you because the discussion was so important. I think you brought in a very interesting dimension into this problem. So if I am to recap what we are talking up to now, Professor Priyanta Vijayathunga brought in the context of this trilemma, and Dr. Tilakseyam Lepitiya brought in this context of how this sustainability and the energy mix can be brought in. As well, now you brought in a new dimension, the new color to the dimension of environment. Now, having that in place, let me go to Dr. Sugathapala in asking the next context is the renewable energy. So, what are your opinions? Are we in the right track? And are we this 2050 targets, what Minister was talking, and present context, are we in the track?
So basically, look at in numbers, and it's difficult to articulate your question, but I could try to come up with some short answers to that one. We can go by the numbers, basically. Like when you look at percent, we have around 460-70 megawatt of systems in place now, apart from the net metering systems. Around 350 energy permits megawatt, and then we have another 300 PAs. So altogether, we have 1,100 megawatt by 2020. We have that one in place, meaning that 20% target is.
In a way, so the achievement to reach the target, something like that, talking about 15%, 20%, 14%, 15%, then now 2020, we are confident that we reach 20%. So, but the issue is basically. That's the question I can answer. In a way, when we have something to analyze upon incident, we need so far beyond that one, but then I think I want to have some criticism in that line. One way of analyzing that one, what the best of doing it. So I think that's the way we can probably think, look at whether we are doing correctly or not.
So ideally, the way we have to deal with renewability is a long-term process, as in Kapatina already indicated, even for generation plan, same to the renewability, maybe it's more difficult. Because renewability is not only energy, that's one of the major difference between the fossil and renewable. I think Honorable Minister also indicated that already, when you look at hydro, we have this agriculture coming there, then human consumption and so on, then we have energy. Energy comes third, right? So then we promote hydro. Same here, when you look at solar and wind, we have the land issue. Land use pattern and so on, because there are other uses of land. When you are using your rooftop, it's different, but still, there are other uses. So then when you look at biomass, more complex. When you look at biomass, we have forestry, we have agriculture, we have timber, and those things. So therefore, we are dealing with a completely different scenario when you look at new energy. So therefore, new energy promotion should occur in that context. So in that context, I would say the ideal way of doing new energy is there are four stages. We start with understand the new energy, that's what we call resource mapping. We have very detailed mapping indicating that the quantity and the quality, the way it varies cyclically, daily and monthly, yearly. That's what Kinetic and Hydro, we discussed that issue. How we vary that influence we should have to take a decision. So in Sri Lanka, I think some resources now we have thing, but the way it happens is different. Second step is basically we go for what is called the resource engineering. Where we take this thing, early on is called technical potential. Now we are looking at really advanced and social potential in a way that you look at the technical components of different technologies related to these new resources. Then you look at what are the social and environmental limitations. For example, forestry, we can't do a resource. The other things also, we come up with that kind of article resource indicating that different region, how much renewable energy in different sources we can, you know, within a particular time frame we can do. That's what we do inventory as a second step. Thirdly, we go for economic thing, the benefit to the society. Then we integrate the policy dimension, as you said, there are. So then we look at the what are the policy targets set by the government, which capture other areas, which can't be quantified in terms of number. So that's why the policy is important, as you said. So we have policy limitations, they are basically policy targets, economics, other benefits, then even some regulation, because we have regulation in terms of grid, there's a limit. You can go because we look up the community. So once you put it together, we come up with what we call resource engineering. Sorry, that is finally what we call the road map. So we have resource
renewable action plan.
Yeah, action plan. So that's what we call road map. So that's, and finally we have implementation. So in the implementation also we have to identify what are the priorities, what are the five technologies, 1, 2, 3, 4, and then keep going. So and then also another important aspect is the region. On day to day, you see that they are also we are correcting on the way which is happening, then you know the feedback of the impact. So we don't have MR, we don't have good monitoring, reporting or verification system to do that. So once we have all this together, so we can feedback to correct this from your roadmap. So that then we have to do it. So in that context, I think we have done that one, but of course we have numbers now. So therefore there is a focus. But the way it happened is not the way it would have done. For example, when you can compare hydro and wind, for example, the hydro is having the best resources. For example, large hydro, best resources of 80%, and then now we are going for the less resources. Now we are studying, we are now deciding whether to do small hydro or not, because there are a lot of resources and impact there. The way it can go for the best resources to the worst resources. Look at the wind, we start with Hambantha, then Tuttalam, then we are going for
Kilot.
Kilot is the best, you know. So, why? That is issue. That means we have some, like, one thing that we have in the future, and also the knowledge on the resources. So we can see we have different way of doing that, you know. So even the solar is completely different. So we cut the solar, we have been starting to put the solar. So if we had only 1 megawatt of solar, or yesterday or today we have not 10 megawatt, yeah, that is speaking more. Look at the rooftop system for the last couple of months. We have, present we have 6.5 megawatt under construction, 1600 system under construction now. We have 6,500 solar rooftop system, contribute 32 megawatt. So we have been, you know, it's within a couple of months, you know, so the way it happened. So it's a different way it's happening. So I'm not saying one is better than the other, it's complex. So I think the renewable energy thing, we have to look at in a very broader way. and then planning. So that's my thing. So therefore we can be satisfied. But the long term, of course, I think we have to be more logical of the unit and also the connection. So that's what I want to touch on that one. It has a long process of evolution process, but we are going for different models now. But basically, feeding has to be there, but that's not the only way of promoting.
Thank you very much, Dr. Sugathapala. Now, having policy, planning, environment, and now we brought in the fourth dimension, renewables. Now, let me to bring in the fifth dimension, nuclear. Now, this question goes to Professor Preenath Das. Now, nuclear, moment somebody says nuclear, people used to say, it's the name of a bomb, let's not have it. What do you think about that? Is it right, or is it too early for us to discuss about that? Or is it too dangerous for us to discuss about that? What is your opinion?
Thank you, Narendra, and good evening. I also would like to thank the organizers of this event for inviting me to be a panelist. Now, to answer to your question, probably the title, Energy Myths and Facts, is probably most appropriate for nuclear energy, because there are many misconceptions on nuclear power. Whether we are going to talk about, whether it is too early to talk about nuclear power. Now, Dr. Siambalapitiya mentioned about the long lead times that you need for energy projects. It is even more so important for nuclear when it comes to nuclear power, because the lead times required is much more than what is required for other types of energy sources. If there is any possibility, I would like to underline that word, possibility of Sri Lanka having to use nuclear power within the next 20 years, this is the time to start talking about it. In fact, we should be doing more than just talking about it, because when it comes to nuclear power, you don't start doing things after you take decisions. There are so many things that you need to do before you are in a position to take a decision to use nuclear power. There are a number of things we need to do. Now, we have very few people in this country who have had any formal training, formal education in nuclear engineering. Our students in their final year have a brief overview of nuclear engineering. And also, several engineers working in the power sector have attended a number of short courses conducted by the IAEA. I think that's about it. We need to do more on human resources development. Doesn't mean that you need to provide specialist engineers, but people who have sufficient knowledge to advise the government in time to come. And also, there are so many other things. Do we have a suitable site for nuclear power? Do we have uranium resources in this country which we can make use of? We need laws and regulations before you can think of nuclear power. So there are a number of things that we need to do before we are in a position to take a decision. These things would not need a lot of financial resources, but these are things that we need to think about doing it if we are thinking of nuclear power within the next 20 years. Now, whether we need nuclear power within 20 years or not, of course, will depend on how rapidly our demand will grow. Right now, the current generation plan estimates a peak demand of 5,000 megawatt in 2030 and about 7,000 megawatt in 2039. So 5,000 is about double the current peak. And the growth will depend on our economic development. Electricity and economic development go hand in hand. When you look at the per capita consumption of various countries and the degree of development, you can clearly see the link. Highly advanced countries like USA, 12,000 kilowatt hours per person per year. Countries like Thailand, about 2,500 kilowatt hours per person per year. Sri Lanka, 525. India, 720. How far do we have to go? What would be our future per capita consumption if we are going to develop our economy?
And in order to do that, what are the energy sources we need? Nuclear could be one of the options we may have to consider. Of course, it will depend on the other energy sources, because you can't look at nuclear power in isolation. So this is one reason we should be talking about nuclear power now, because of the long lead times. The second reason is, as I mentioned, there are so many misconceptions about nuclear power, which needs to be cleared. Like as Dr. Narendra mentioned, a lot of people think about a bomb the moment you mention nuclear technology, think it's highly dangerous. There are many misconceptions about nuclear power that needs to be cleared. And the third reason we should be talking about nuclear power is there are so many new developments that are taking place. A large number of companies, vendors, are in the process of developing small nuclear power plants with highly advanced features which are suitable for small developing countries like ours. We need people, knowledgeable persons, who can monitor these developments and see whether we can benefit from them in time to come. The present generation of nuclear power plants, it's known as generation 2 plants, are not suitable for countries like ours. But what are under development, called generation 3 plus nuclear power plants, have number of features that could make it suitable for countries like ours. So I think these are the three reasons why we should be talking about nuclear power. As I said, we should not only talk about nuclear power plants, nuclear power, but also there are certain things we need to do if you want to keep the option of using nuclear power within the 20 years, we want to keep that option open. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Dias. Having the nuclear option open, please don't, I think I have not forgotten Buddhika, so I'm coming to the trickiest question, I suppose, with Buddhika. Having the entire premise set, let me ask this question. Now, this, we are talking about an LNG plant. Yes. Are we right in time? Are we bringing in LNG at the right time? What is your opinion?
Okay, I should not say yes or no at this stage. I will elaborate some more things. Actually, when you look at our energy mix previously, we had all the things except LNG. That means we had hydro, we had wind, okay, solar, now it's moving, and the thermal base. I think we commissioned our coal power plant in 2012. I think it was planned in 1996. Maybe it should be commissioned by a commission in 2001, 2002. I think almost 10 years later, we commissioned the coal power plant. Once we commissioned the coal power plant, I think all the people in the country get the benefit. That means the tariff reduction. I think that's the ultimate aim country's people looking for. That we have to think. And when you look at the previous LNG prices and the coal prices, normally LNG prices are linked with the oil prices. That's the trend. I think present trend also as it is, but now most of the majority of the countries, they are switching to LNG as well. Maybe normally they call LNG as a club. That means LNG trading is a club. That means they will request some fixed quantities. When you look at our requirements, when you look at only at the power, our quantities are very low. That we have to think before we introduce LNG into the system. And previously LNG prices are very high because of the coal, oil prices. Now very recently, I think after 2010-2011, USA found this shale gas, and after that LNG prices become reduced. Because of that, now at present LNG prices are somewhat cheaper compared with the previous prices. And why we need LNG? That's the other thing we have to think. Definitely
Now we have one coal power plant in our system, and we need the power plant in our load center. That means mainly in the Colombo area. And we are having nearly 700 megawatt of combined cycle power plants running on diesel. When you compare the power plants operate using diesel and LNG, LNG is cheap. That's the world situation. But if we want to introduce a LNG power plant into a system having around 700 megawatt, it's not economically feasible. But I think with this present government, they also have taken a decision on the introduction of LNG. CB latest approved long-term generation expansion plan, we have included the 300 megawatt LNG power plant at Keravalapitiya with the conversion of existing power plant. And also, that's not the only power plant we introduce in this generation plan, because we are preparing for a 20-year planning horizon. Let's say if we want, if we need another power plant in Colombo, definitely it should be an extension of the, because LNG, we need to have so many other infrastructure. That means terminal or the FSRU. That terminal or FSRU can handle around 1 million tons per annum or 1.5 million tons per annum. That means that can serve more than 1,000, 1,500 megawatt of combined cycle power plants. Definitely, but it should be a phased development. That means we have to maintain our energy mix. Otherwise, our ultimate objective is to provide the electricity at least cost. That's the people, because I think our consumers, they may need the lowest electricity costs. They like to have the clean environment, they need the clean fuel, and I don't know whether they prefer to get the power from coal or LNG or any other renewable resources, but ultimately they need the cheapest power. That's the one aspect we have to look into. But from a utility point of view, we have to look into the other aspect as well. Because of that, I think we should have a proper energy mix. That means we should have a, let's say for the solar, now we government now trying to give 22 rupees. Definitely, yes, that we have to promote that one. But where we subsidize that one? That means our selling prices now, average selling price is around 16 rupees. Definitely, we should have a low-cost generation options. And if LNG generation cost is more than 16 rupees, what would be the impact on our selling price? That we have to think. But definitely, since we need the power plant in Colombo, Keravalapitiya, because that's our load center, I think this decision is correct at present, because we are trying to introduce LNG into Keravalapitiya. That decision, I think, is correct decision.
Okay, thank you very much, Buddhika. Now, Professor Priyanta Vijayadunga's trilemma, security, affordability, and sustainability. Namita, we have not much talked about the affordability. I'm turning myself to you.